Welcome you to our seminar. So before introducing our speaker today, I just want to tell you that there was some email exchange between these One World seminars in the last days, and some of the other organizers reported on their activities, on the fact that they want to have a summer break, and on the number of participants. And I want to tell you that the optimization seminar is doing great. Yeah, so we have a fantastic participation. I'd like to thank you for being here in this room every Monday afternoon. And of course, I want to thank the speakers we had in the last weeks, and great speakers. And today we will have the honor. We have the honor to have a speaker, Yuri Nesterov, who is a great personality of our research area. With a very important contribution, with an important impact in the research we are all doing. So, he did a lot for our field, and he's still doing a lot. It is our greatest honor to have Yuri Nesterov talking in this seminar. And on a very nice title, on super fast second order methods. And of course, Yuri promoted the fast method, and now we are talking about super fast. So,
yes,
thank you, Yuri, for accepting our invitation.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Radu. It is my pleasure to speak here. So I'm sorry, I'm not very familiar with all this new style of presentation. So if you don't hear something or whatever, so just let me know. It is quite difficult to speak without seeing people and so on. But okay, now we have no choice. So let us maybe start. Maybe I should explain a little bit the title. The title of the talk, Super Fast Second Order Methods. So which means that these are the methods which work faster than we expect from the methods of this type in accordance to the low complexity bounds. So this happens not the first time in optimization when we get methods which work better than the lower complexity bound. So remember about the smoothing technique and so on, when we get gradient type methods for non-smooth problems which are working much faster than the lower complexity bounds. And each time, so this is related that somehow we violate the condition of this lower complexity bound. Therefore, it is again so one more confirmation that we should be very careful with this negative facts that something cannot work faster than something proved, because so these statements, of course, they are correct, they are mathematically correct, but they indeed assume something very often quite strict things about the methods. And if we violate even little bit of this stuff, so the bounds already are not valid anymore. And therefore, so we should always hope that for many methods we can get much better results than so we have from these negative facts. And actually, the methods which I am going to present today, they are related somehow with maybe the most important activity of the last year, at least from the viewpoint of new results. This is the development of tensor methods for unconstrained minimization problem. So I recall you actually, so what is this? So all of that was done really not very far, so long time ago. So it is indeed, I don't know, 3 years, maybe 2-3 years. So all of these results. So we're speaking about the methods for minimizing unconstrained minimization. Yes, so we have a convex function without constraints. E is just finite dimensional space. Just think that this is Rn, if you want. And F is just differentiable function, convex differentiable function on the whole space. Now, so as mathematicians like to do always, so let us try to approximate our function somehow by Taylor approximation. Yeah, so we just stay at the point X, we compute derivatives of the order up to the order P, and then we can write down this Taylor polynomial, so the famous thing which is intensively used in the analysis. So which should approximate well our function? The higher is the degree of the polynomial, the better is the approximation. So by analyzing this polynomial, so we could have better methods. Okay, so in principle, so in optimization, during all history optimization, usually people were restricted by very small numbers of p. P equal to 1, this is the first order approximation, and we get gradient type method, p equal to 2. This is the second order approximation, and so on. But now, so we allow us to think about bigger values of this polynomial. Now, this polynomial is a good approximation of our function if we have the Lipschitz condition for the last derivative. The last derivative in this series must be Lipschitz continuous. Yes, and then actually we can construct so-called augmented Taylor polynomial. So what is it? We just take the Taylor polynomial that is here, and we add a regularization term of the high power. Note that here p is greater or equal to 1, so the power here may be 2, 3, 4, and so on. So the high order regularization term, and we get this augmented Taylor polynomial, which we denote by omega hat, which actually this is the main property of this object, so is an upper bound, uniform upper bound for our function, so at all points y in the whole space. Yeah, so this is a very simple exercise in nonlinear analysis to prove that if we augment so this Taylor polynomial by this proximal term, so we get uniform upper bound. And as usual, if we have an upper model, if you want, of our objective function, it is a very natural idea for people in minimization, just to try to get the next test point, so to move from x to a better point, which should be a kind of minimum of this right-hand side. So in this way, we at least are able to decrease the value of the objective function. Very nice, so it was absolutely trivial and clear, I don't know, in many years, but there is one difficulty, actually, which that didn't allow us to work with this object, so with the degree of polynomial bigger than 2. Just because, so if p is bigger than 2, we already have a very complicated object here. Yeah, so just think about the third order approximation. So we have in the right hand side the third order multidimensional polynomial, which is augmented by something. So in this with p equal to 2, this is the power of 4. And what we can do with this? So actually everybody knows that minimization of non-convex polynomials of degree 4, this is the NP-hard problem. So what can be useful from working with these objects? And this question actually remained open during many years, and only recently actually so we realized very simple fact that if our function f is convex and the proximal constant in our polynomial, I recall you what is h, h is the coefficient here, yeah, so is big enough, then this augmented Taylor polynomial is convex. So this result really, for me, it was very unexpected. So just because we know, so it is really known to all students that we cannot regularize non-convex function by the high powers of Euclidean norm. Look what happens. Let us look at p equal to 3. So just one dimensional situation. We take t cube, okay? Think about as a Taylor polynomial of degree 3. We add here with positive constant t to the power of 4. And we get a function which is never convex. Doesn't matter how big is this coefficient h. So the result would be never convex in the neighborhood of zero. So we always have the change of the sign of the second derivative. So in general, this is absolutely impossible to get something like that for general polynomials, but it appears that if this guy is a polynomial, Taylor polynomial of convex function, then the situation is absolutely different. So we get a possibility to regularize this guy with sufficiently moderate value of this penalty. So it is proportional more or less to the Lipschitz constant for the last derivative. Okay, as a corollary, so we can speak about the implementable methods just like this. Okay, consider the point which minimizes the convex function, and we can say that in principle it is computable. So at this moment I don't discuss this, how it can be computed, but in principle this is a convex problem, and we know that convex problems are solved. So this opens a possibility to apply the tensor method of different type. So the simplest one is the basic tensor method, when we just iterate this tensor step with appropriate value of h, and then so we can prove for this guy the convergence rate proportional to k to the minus p. Again, let us play a little bit with this p. P is equal to 1, then this is 1 over k, so this is the gradient method. K is equal to 1 over k square, this is the Newton, but after that so we get already something which was not known, 1 over k cube, so this is the tensor method of 3 and so on. Now, using the same technique as for gradient method, we can speak about accelerated tensor methods. Yes, where, so we will look at variants of this method a little bit later, therefore here I just show you the result. So they converge faster than the basic tensor methods. They converge with the rate k to the power minus p plus 1. Yeah, so for example, for p equal to 2 second order scheme, this is already k to the minus 3, for p equal to 3, k to the minus 4, and so on. Okay, very nice. Actually, this possibility of acceleration of the tensor method was realized by Michel Baez quite a long time ago. But actually, Michel was very disappointed at this time that despite to the good global complexity results, so it was impossible to solve the auxiliary problem. He didn't know about this fact. And therefore, he even didn't publish his results. So it remains up to now as a research report in our archive, I think. And only 10 years later, so after realizing that this is true, more or less redid what Michel was doing for accelerated tensor methods. And we have now the implementable tensor methods, and the structure of this method so is follows from the acceleration technique which we have more or less for the gradient scheme, so which is called estimating sequences. Now at the same time, actually there is a kind of competitive line of research which is originated from Monteiro and Schweitzer in their paper in 2014. For p equal to 2, they proposed the method, second order scheme, which is faster than this tensor method. Yeah. So for p equal to 2, so we have k to the minus 3, and with their technique, actually it was possible to reach, just put here p equal to 2, so 3.5. Okay, a little bit faster technique, but unfortunately, so this was achieved by very expensive line search procedure. In this accelerated methods, actually, we don't need line search at all, but they need line search, very expensive line search, at which step of this, internal step of this line search, so this is a line search for non-convex function. And you really need to find the root of some convex function, and each computation of this function is a solution of, I don't know, auxiliary problem like that. So everything is very complicated, but still so formally, so in this way, extending their technique on the tensor methods, it is possible. It was done independently by this, different research teams. So we can have the tensor method with this rate of convergence. Okay, with again, so we I recall you that this is the the need expensive language. Now, so why this result is interesting? Just because it appears again, several groups of people more or less at the same time came to this conclusion that this is the maximal rate which can be achieved for corresponding methods, so of the order p, which means that for p equal 2, we cannot converge faster than k to the minus 7 divided by 2. For p equal 3, it is k to the minus 5. So we get, in this sense, we have optimal, or if you want, suboptimal, because in the complexity bounds here we have the logarithmic factors. So which cannot be improved on this for this type of method. So the only difficulty which remains after all these theoretical results is the implementation. Yeah, so how we can implement these tensor iterations, and do we indeed have the working algorithm for practical problems? So, and the answer is yes for some cases. So, and one of them is the accelerated third order method, where it appears that the auxiliary problem can be solved quite efficiently. So this method is important for our conclusion. So therefore, let me just explain what's going on. So now we're working with third order method, so which means that we need to assume Lipschitz continuity of the third derivative. So if we are able to compute the third derivative, when we compute the Taylor, augmented Taylor polynomial of degree 3, what is it? So we have the usual quadratic part of the objective. We add the cubic term and our regularization term. Our regularization term is of the order 4 now. So this is nice quadratic function, but again, so it can make the whole structure convex only because of the convexity of it. So what is special with this polynomial? So at each iteration, we need to minimize this guy somehow. We need to have an efficient technique for doing that. It appears, and this is again, so very strong consequence of convexity of function, that the third order term in this contraction is never strong. In this sense, so it is always dominated by the combination of the second order term and the fourth order term. So these two convex guys together are always stronger than the impact of this third order term. So let me just show the proof, because this is really the very trivial observation, but it indeed solves the problem. So why this is true? Why the third derivative of convex function is never strong, is always weaker than second and fourth derivative? Yes, so the proof is just trivial. So let us take two point X, a displacement H in our space, and look at the matrix at the Hessian at the point X minus H. Yeah? Our function is convex, therefore this Hessian is positive definite. So we have the lower bound on this Hessian, but on the other hand, we have an upper bound, which comes from the Taylor approximation of this guy using the third derivative, plus the term which comes from the Lipschitz continuity of the third derivative. We have an upper bound, so this is the matrix, which is always bigger in the matrix sense than the Hessian at x minus 9, and which is non-negative. So now, if you look, what is this? It's exactly this inequality. Yeah? The third order term is always weaker. So then these two guys. So this allows us to work with the preconditioner special function in this form. So this is a combination. So its structure comes from this inequality, of course. This is the combination of the quadratic function and the power of Euclidean norm of degree 4. So from this fact, so which we have here, it can be proved that we always have the compatibility of the Hessians of our augmented Taylor polynomial of degree 3 and this simple function. This is again, so this is a simple function. You can imagine that we can easily find the minimum of this function plus linear term and all things like that. But it appears that it's their Hessians, they're almost proportional to the Hessian already of our nonlinear function, this augmented Taylor polynomial. And look at the left and the right hand side of this inequality. So in both cases, so these are the absolute constants, which is very unusual. In some sense, the condition number of this function with respect to this function rho is an absolute constant, which means that with this preconditioner, the problem of minimizing this guy is very easy. So this can be done using the framework which is called relative non-degeneracy condition. Okay, so this condition appeared so first maybe in the paper by Babushkin, Bolt, Tibul in 2016 when they analyzed the consequences of the right hand side of this inequality. Two years later we analyzed the consequences of the left hand side of this inequality, and it appears that both together, so these things, they give us very efficient minimization scheme. So let me just show you the general result, what we can do in this situation. So if we minimize function without constraints, so, and if we have a scaling function, which is strictly convex, you don't say that it is strongly convex, it is only strict convexity what we need. And we need, so, the compatibility of the Hessians. Yeah, first of all, so this function should be simple, but the main thing is that we need the compatibility of the Hessian. The Hessians of this simple function are proportional to the Hessians of our main function. So then we can apply the framework of Bregman distance. So we have introduced Bregman distance with respect to this function rho from the point x to y. So this is the difference between the value at y and the linear prediction of this value at the point x from convexity, of course. So this thing is non-negative. And the main property is that from this compatibility condition, so the Bergman distance between x and y with respect to function f, so when we put here our objective, is compatible with the Bergman distance with respect to the function rho, so simple rho function. And therefore, so we can apply so-called Bergman distance gradient method, which is just the minimization at each iteration, we minimize the linear model plus, so this term, so with the constant L, which is an upper, gives us an upper bound for the value of the objective function at the next point. The idea of this method is very natural, and actually I do not know where it appeared first. So I saw first this scheme for non-smooth optimization in the paper by Bechtibul many years ago, you see 2003. So the Amir Bek and Mark Tibul, when they were thinking about applying this construction in the framework of Mirow-Descent method. So for smooth optimization, I don't know actually, but I definitely used it in my paper about smooth minimization of non-smooth functions, so this stuff, but maybe something was earlier. But anyway, so at that time, so this construction was not very interesting because it was considered as an alternative to the gradient step, gradient method. So there was nothing about relative non-degeneracy. And for us, it is the most important application of this construction is related to this relative non-degeneracy because it gives us linear convergence rate for this process, okay, which depends only the condition number mu and L for our, so this scaling function, which again in our case is extremely efficient. Mu is a constant, L is a constant, therefore condition number is also a constant. Therefore, for our auxiliary process, so we converge very quickly, as in bisection, so with a constant linear rate. So let us look now at this accelerated, the corresponding accelerated third order method. So how it looks like? Well, it looks more or less the same as all of these methods based on estimating sequences. We start from some distance function. So in this case, it is better to take the power 4 of Euclidean norm. So we define in advance the coefficients. So now the coefficients grow quite quickly, proportionally to the fourth power of the index. Okay, and now, so at each iteration, we have two points. One is the minimum of our estimating function, and the second one is the point where we have good value of the objective function. This is xk. We take compute intermediate point in this. now we generate the. This is again misprint. Of course, here it should be yk. I'm sorry, not xk, but we take all gradients at the point yk here. Okay, and the intermediate point. So now what is new? So we introduce this preconditioner, so which depends only on the Hessian at this point yk, and we minimize our function, so this augmented Taylor polynomial of degree 3 using the Bregman distance gradient method. So just iterate this method, so for this function h. At some moment, the method converges very quickly, so with linear rate, we stop, there is a stopping criterion, and we update our function. This is it. So just the usual scheme. So for which we can prove, its rate of convergence. The convergence is k to the power minus 4. Okay, but let us look carefully at this scheme, and let us answer maybe question: what is the order of this method? What is the order of this scheme? Let us look at it. Okay, so we need to run this procedure. For this procedure, we need to compute first derivative, second derivative, and also we need to compute the gradient here of the third derivative, which means this is the value of the third derivative on two times on the same vector. So this is a vector, the gradient is a vector. So the naive answer would be, this is of course the scheme of the order 3. But actually the answer is not correct, because as we know from first year course in nonlinear analysis, so this vector can be approximated with arbitrary high accuracy just by difference of the gradients. So if tau is infinitely small, this vector can be computed just using the first order oracle, which means that this scheme can be implemented using only the second order oracle. And for this implementation of the second order scheme, we will have the rate of convergence proportional to k to the minus 4. Yeah, very nice. So why not? So we have a good convergence rate. But the problem is that we need to answer what happens now with the lower complexity bounds for the second order schemes, which is k to the power minus 7 divided by 2. This is worse than this. So we get the second order scheme which converges faster than the corresponding lower complexity bounds. Okay, so this is the main observation, and this is the main reason why I call this implementation of the third order method the super fast second order scheme, just because they have convergence faster than the well-known lower complexity bound for the second order scheme. Okay, before we answer so to this contradiction, let me just mention very briefly, because I don't have too much time to go into details, to explain how all of that can be done. It is clear that this can be done, yes, but we need some, I don't know, to write down 20 pages to justify so how it is done. How it can be done. So we need to clarify some implementation details where we need to justify the tensor method with inexact tensor steps. Inexact means that we stop here earlier before we get the exact solution of this guy. We need to justify the Bregman distance gradient method, which works with inexact gradients, and write down the bounds, because we don't want to have this step size tau too small, the scheme becomes unstable and so on. So, but all of that can be done with some efforts, but what do we get now? We need the second order method with the rate of convergence to the power k to the minus 4. And at each iteration, the complexity is not very high. Indeed, we have some search procedure, but we know that it converges with linear rate. Therefore, so this number of calls of Oracle is definitely enough to implement this this rate of convergence. And so what is our problem class? Actually, problem class is now the function with bounded fourth derivative. With bounded fourth derivative. And this is actually the answer. So why we get better convergence rate than the lower bound given us by the standard reasoning for the second order schemes. We just apply our second order methods to other problem class. But now actually, so let us try to think what does it mean? Because there are some consequences for theory and for application. So from all this strange situation. So it appears that our class, standard class of functions, which we traditionally consider for the second order schemes, so which is the functions with Lipschitz continuous Hessian or with bounded third derivative, which is more or less the same, it is not very good. So what we have can prove now is that if you look at the maximal bound, maximal third derivative of convex function, it is always smaller than the combination of this bound for the second derivatives and for the fourth derivatives. In this sense, third derivative is not independent. It is always weaker than these two guys. We have seen things like that, so several slides before. And therefore, in our result, there is no contradiction. Okay, so we are just working with bounded these two guys, and which means we are working with subclass of the function with the bounded third derivative. So of course there is no contradiction with the low complexity bounds. Now, so what we can see from this complexity results that actually, so we managed to apply the lower order method to the functional class, which before was considered as a natural for the higher order method. Our low order method, the second order method, so works with functions with bounded fourth derivative. This was the field for higher order methods. And moreover, so this second order scheme on this problem class gives us the same complexity bounds. It is not worse, which means that in principle, actually, so there is no excuse for existing the, at least at this moment, it looks like. There is no excuse for existing the third order schemes because all results, complexity results, which we can obtain for the third order scheme, so we are able to obtain using the second order schemes. And moreover, now our complexity theory becomes much more sophisticated. Look, so before, so it was possible, and people did that, okay, now it appears that it is not absolutely correct, to speak about the optimal first order method, optimal second order method, optimal third order methods. This was possible just because, so there was one-to-one correspondence between the order of the methods and the problem class. Yes, for the first order method, so we had functions with Lipschitz continuous gradient, for the second Lipschitz continuous Hessian, and so on. So one-to-one correspondence. Now this nice picture, one-dimensional picture is destroyed. Now we see that it is possible to apply with success the lower order methods to the classes which were attributed before to the high order methods. Therefore, in some sense, we have two-dimensional picture now. And we have parameters of the function, which is the order of bounded derivative, but also, so we can play with the order of the method. Nobody says that the lower order methods so will be worse than the high order methods on the corresponding problem classes. So in this sense, so we need to fill the complexity table now. In this table, so from our previous knowledge, we know only the diagonal, but now we need to fill it all. Okay, so everything becomes much more interesting. And just maybe to finish, let us try to understand what happens with the lower complexity bounds. How comes that all our nice lower complexity bounds were so misleading? Why they didn't work properly for the second order schemes? So let us look actually. So I have some explanation for that. So not the theorems, but so some explanation what happens. Let us look how we derived the lower complexity bounds for different methods. So let us start from function with bounded second derivative, which means Lipschitz continuous gradient. So the lower complexity bound which we get there is k to the minus 2. Yeah, so the bound which is we usually applied for the first order methods. How it was obtained? It was obtained by the worst function in the world, so which was just a quadratic function. So at the quadratic function of this type, so we see that the first order methods cannot converge faster than that. What is interesting to this function? Just it is very interesting that this is quadratic, which means that derivative of the order p greater than 3 for this function are zeros, which means that we cannot get any help assuming boundedness of the high order derivative. They are already at the smallest possible level. So high order assumption cannot help us in minimizing this function. Okay, let us go to the next. A class function with bounded third derivative, so second order methods. The lower bound k to the minus 7 divided by 2. What was the worst function in the world for this class? It was the sum of the cubes. So the same structure, but here instead of square, we have cubes. And exactly at this function, we get this lower complexity bound. What is bad with this function? The third derivative is discontinuous. Therefore, the fourth derivative doesn't exist. And therefore, so this function can be cut from our considerations using assumption of the fourth derivative, for example. Yeah. So this function is very bad in this sense. It is easy to cut it from the problem class, and this means that it is with this new assumption, it is easy to get better problem class with better low complexity bound. Let us look at the next class, function with bounded fourth derivative, for which the lower complexity bound is k to the minus 5. And then again, so this worst function in the world is a polynomial. Is a polynomial of degree 4. This is not a polynomial. but this is polynomial and this is polynomial. So all derivatives of the order p greater than 5 are again zeros here. Yes. So this means that we cannot expect any help from bounding this high order derivative. So to improve this lower complexity bounds, which means that the bounds here and here are in this sense unimprovable. And for our goal for the second order schemes should be of proving this rate of convergence for the correspondence as second order. But again, all of that is just, let me say, some speculation. So it's better to transform all of that in some theory. So this is more or less all what I wanted to show you today. Actually, I just want to show you some, let me say, next steps. So today I was speaking about the super fast second order methods. So more or less, so we did this in the beginning of the year, and it is published in a core discussion paper. So now there is a continuation actually of this story. So this continuation is called inexact accelerated high order proximal point methods, which actually are trying to accelerate this second order method in some systematic way. And this systematic way is based on high order proximal points. This is quite unusual, let me say, object, but still, so it works. And I will be speaking about that actually tomorrow. As you know, so many conferences are canceled, but some of them are now in the online regime. And for this conference, same conference, Mathematics of Data Science. So tomorrow at 7 p.m. European time, so I will have a presentation which explains so what can be done in this way, okay, in order to get systematically these super fast second order methods and others. So everybody is welcome, I think, just to attend this talk. I think it will be translated to everybody. And the last thing which we have in this direction is already a little bit more complicated situation. This is even faster methods, second order methods. So which give us for the second order scheme, so the rate of convergence is proportional to k to the minus 5. So this is already indeed very fast rate. So everything here is based, it needs some auxiliary line search, but in principle everything is implementable. So in this complexity we have just logarithmic factors which maybe are not very very important. Anyway, so I will continue to discuss this framework tomorrow at 7 o'clock, and thank you for your attention.
So thank you very much, Yuri, for the very nice talk, very clear talk, very impressive development, impressive results.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. It is time for questions. So you can unmute your microphones or ask questions in the chat. Yes?
I don't hear anything.
There was a voice.
No.
Okay. So then there was a question in the chat if there are some particular applications for these algorithms. I mean,
well, I think that they can be used everywhere. So we use the second order schemes, not even the second order scheme. So I will be discussing that tomorrow. So because now, so to apply even the first order schemes, so in for the classes which are usually treated by the high order methods. You know that when we have a particular problem, so usually we do not have very precise idea what is the problem class, so for this function. Usually, so the functions are differentiable. Very often, they are differentiable infinitely many times. And so, what is the reason for our decision that this should be treated by the second order schemes, or this should be treated by the first order schemes? All of that is very fuzzy. So, in this sense, so I will be speaking about that tomorrow. So, we get a new framework, so which allows to apply the lower order methods on the better problem classes. So the thing which was absent before, because there was one-to-one correspondence between the problem class and the type of the method. But now we have much more freedom, and I expect to have much faster practical algorithms in this direction.
So thank you. We have a question from Oksana Pichugina. If there are any, okay, Oksana, would you like to ask the question? Or I can read it. So if there are any results, experimental results in terms of dimension of problems?
No, I mean, so all these theories, so this rate of convergence and so on, they are dimension independent. And the dimension, of course, enters the picture when you are trying to solve this auxiliary problem, when you compute the oracles and so on. But in some sense, maybe this is good, because if you have an oracle which is sparse and all these derivatives are also sparse, so you can maybe easily compute this minimums of these Taylor polynomials, augmented Taylor polynomials by some simple methods, and then you can apply this technique even to the problems of very high dimension.
So we have two more questions, or two further questions. Negin BGH. Otherwise, you tried to ask the question, but something went wrong with the mic. So then let me read it. So if there is any version relying on convexification, such as superposition.